In this video, I'd like to give an overview of gay theater or gay performance. And I'm not altogether sure what I mean by that. Gay persons have been involved in the theater long before the 1960s, the 70s, and beyond. And theater had been hospitable to homosexuals for centuries prior to our time, and had been responsible for many important innovations and outstanding achievements in the theater in various capacities as actors, designers, directors, as well as dramatists and producers. So what I mean by gay performance is the efforts since the 60s, particularly since the 80s and 90s and present century, to represent varieties of gay experience on the stage. For while much of theater history was the work of gay persons, the theater did not represent gay experience very forthrightly or at all until starting in the 1960s, but really in the decades that followed, do you find theater calling attention to the varieties of gay experience and providing different perspectives on gay experience. So I wanted to discuss sort of the evolution of this representation of gay experience in the theater since the 1960s up to the present, to show an evolution and the ways in which theater has contrast perspectives on gay experience. Back in the 1960s, much of what the theater represented as gay experience was actually the work of heterosexuals who had some special purpose in including gay characters in their plays or showing some aspect of gay life in their plays, which actually represented a heterosexual view of the world as they saw it. And as a result, they presented gay experience as somehow an adjunct to a heterosexual way of looking at the world. Nevertheless, in the 1960s, some plays received attention to their representation of gay experience, even if it was the work of heterosexual authors, such as Frank Marcus, who in 1964 wrote a very popular play called The Killing of Sister George, which became a movie that ran into censorship troubles, and that's a problem in those days with representing gay experience, which for the most part in throughout the United States and many other countries was actually an illegal experience and subject to criminal prosecution. So putting on plays about homosexuals invited controversy, as did The Killing of Sister George, which described two women who were involved with the production of a soap opera, an English play, and the author Marcus intended the play to be a comedy about power relations between women in relation to this television show, this popular expression of popular culture. And the play became actually a kind of serious drama as a result simply of showing the homosexual relation between the two, the producer of the show and the person who works for her, and the efforts of the TV company to kill Sister George, the character that this woman in the play, one of the lesbian lovers, plays on television. And the film came out and had a very controversial scene with nudity between two women. And same can be said of John Osborne, who in 1965 wrote another play that had all kinds of troubles with the censors in England, A Patriot for Me, a political drama with a huge cast. I believe I mentioned this play in an earlier video. But here Osborne included a drag scene in which men of the 1890s in Vienna dress up as women for a ball. These were officers and diplomats, and Osborne's purpose was to show that the society of that time involved these men playing some geopolitical game, but at the same time leading concealed lives from the public and from each other when going to so-called normal lives, and in this situation in which they have a ball, they assume the identity of the opposite sex and disclose their homosexual identities. So it really wasn't about homosexuality, but a play that included a homosexual element to make point to support this critique of society that Osborne, that was the main objective of Osborne's play. Then in 1968, Mart Crowley had a very successful play in Broadway called The Boys in the Band. And The Boys in the Band presented this party, a birthday party, involving, I believe it's seven gay men. They gather in an apartment in New York City to celebrate the 40th birthday, I believe it is, of one of the characters who lives in the apartment. And the boys in the band at the party engage in all kinds of self-criticism and criticism of each other. And the play showed a kind of dissatisfaction or unhappiness with being homosexuality, you know, men snapping at each other or teasing each other, manifest this kind of self-disgust, loathing. And the play subsequently has come in for a lot of criticism because it doesn't present a positive enough image of gay life. But in 1968, the play attracted a great deal of attention because it was about gay characters, made no real reference to anybody outside of the gay circles within the... The play gave an opportunity for audiences to see what gay life was really like, in how gays felt about each other, and the intensity of the play is such that the audiences also got some idea of the degree to which gays thought about themselves as a problem for each other, for society, and for themselves. And it does treat gay identity as a kind of affliction. And now remember that Jean Genet was perhaps at that time the most prominent homosexual writer in the theater. Even though his plays didn't altogether, they weren't very explicit about homosexuality in the 1950s. But people were able to read a subtext in it, such as in The Maids, where the two female servants clearly have a homosexual relation to each other. And in Genet's stage directions, which require that he wanted men to play the maids, or in The Balcony and The Blacks, a recurring theme is the masks that people wear in presenting themselves to society, and this whole idea of mask and masquerade as the true basis of identity rather than something behind the mask. At that time, many people read as a subtext for a homosexual identity, which had to be in the closet or concealed, suppressed, or lived in secret and behind a mask. So Genet, you can, even though he was clearly an author pursuing a homosexual aesthetic, did not represent gay experience as forthrightly as those authors, such as I just mentioned, Marcus, Osborne, and Crowley did, even if they weren't altogether gay themselves. Then in 1970, Charles Ludlam rose to prominence, a very flamboyant character. Every year around Christmas, he used to play, do a Christmas carol. He did this, a Christmas carol show in New York City, for which he was famous and beloved. But for the rest of the year, he got involved in what he called the Theater of the Ridiculous. And he had a little theater down in Greenwich Village in which he performed his own plays. He had his own ensemble, his own company of his friends, and they put on these wild spoofs of what he called ridiculous culture. And these were gay parodies of popular culture icons. He brought to the theater a very overt camp sensibility, camp, this kind of self-conscious use of popular icons and images in an exaggerated way to make fun of them, to treat them as absurdities rather than as objects of adoration. Or so in the Theater of the Ridiculous, he staged one play after the other. He was very prolific, cranking out plays. Perhaps his most popular play, or the one I enjoy the most, is Bluebeard, which he wrote in 1970. And this is a camp satire on all kinds of conventions and popular horror and science fiction movies from the 1940s and 50s, and The Island of Dr. Moreau, the Bluebeard legend, and Dracula, and Victorian Gothic novels, and so forth. And he puts all these tropes, these iconic characters from popular culture, has them coming together in drag and with cross-gender casting and kinds of actually pretty funny lines and it's kind of a messy sort of aesthetic, but primarily a fun, exuberant kind of send-up of a treasured cultural images and values. The purpose of the camp aesthetic is in the end to subvert the normative power of these popular cultural figures and images to establish a normal way of looking at the world. And Ludlam transforms them into ridiculous objects of ridiculous fun, you might say. So Ludlum, he died in 1987, rather prematurely, only in his 40s, mid-40s or so. At the same time, Charles Bush pursued a different kind of camp aesthetic, whereas Ludlum wrote his own plays and then had the figure, he played these different pop culture figures in extravagant drag kinds of impersonations. Bush pursued a different kind of drag aesthetic. He became prominent in the 70s for his impersonations of different female characters, female movie stars, female figures in popular culture, female figures from his own family life. And he would change costumes. Basically, it was a one-man show that he did, and he would incarnate these different female figures and with different voices and different gestures and whatnot. And he carried on a tradition that had been happening not so much in the theater but in nightclubs for decades previously, the female impersonator act. And then he moved to a more ambitious kind of theater in the 1980s after his solo impersonation act seemed to lose their audience or lose their power of attraction or something like that. He followed up with, kind of following in the footsteps of Ludlum with his most popular play, Lesbians, Vampire Lesbians of Sodom, 1984. And this was an entire, it was like a drag review show. It had a plot and a story of sorts dealing with vampires in some kind of special world in which gays had their own laws or rules for governing it. And it had enormous success, played for years in New York City. And then imitations in other cities, one of them here in San Francisco, Beach Blanket Babylon, is a kind of Charles Bush, Charles Ludlum kind of gay production pursues this camp sensibility, drag impersonations, and exaggerated, ridiculous spoofs of pop cultural icons that serve to stabilize or render normal some kind of worldview that they don't think, these authors do not think, is all that normal. It's absurd. And the purpose of drag performance, and indeed the purpose of homosexuality, is to reveal that absurdity and produce a kind of alternate reality, a different possibility of living that follows utterly different rules about who's male and female and what is normal and what is perverse. Because in the world of the ridiculous or the camp sensibility, a different idea of normality prevails, and encountering that in the theater, you become aware of the constraints of normality on your own life as a spectator, whether you were gay or not. Bush and Ludlum were working in this off-Broadway theater economy, which I mentioned in one of my earlier videos. And occasionally it moves on to Broadway. Ludlum was on Broadway when he did A Christmas Carol, and Bush moved his drag performances on Broadway occasionally. But primarily the camp sensibilities prospered in this little theater environment on the fringe of theater culture rather than in the mainstream. And as long as it remained there, it was, it was marginal. And for that reason, to a large extent, harmless. It was a way of packaging gayness or keeping it contained in a way that was not satisfying for other gay writers who wanted to pursue something more serious and deal with aspects of gayness that didn't fit into this party kind of atmosphere that... So, in 1979, Martin Sherman produced Bent, a play set in Germany in the 1930s, at the time the Nazis rose to power, and showing the persecution of gays by the Nazis, and the power of homosexual love to transcend this persecution and oppression. It's a dark and violent play, which those who pursue a homosexual desire die. They meet a tragic fate. And yet, the purpose of the play is to show that even though they are extinguished by this cruel regime, their love somehow, the love between the men in the play, somehow becomes revealed to them, and the strength of it becomes evident because of the efforts to suppress it or deny it or destroy it by the Nazis. So Bent had a really great resonance when it came out in 1979 and sort of opened the door to a more serious approaches to homosexuality than had prevailed. Larry Kramer in 1985 produced The Normal Heart. That play became popular throughout the nation. It's still revived. I think a new revival is on the way in San Francisco, and another one was happening in New York. It's a play about AIDS. It's a play about gay men who have to grapple with it and deal with it and acknowledge their desires for each other in spite of this disease, rather than allowing the disease to suppress their desires or to hide who they are. And so the play, I guess, is about how the disease pressures gay men to disclose the measure of courage within them to pursue their homosexual desires, acknowledge them, and triumph over the disease, or to acknowledge and cultivate their desires in spite of the disease. Even though the play came in for a lot of criticism for not having a very, a very exciting theater aesthetic, it's basically a very talky play. Conversation from beginning to end, arguments and squabbles and patient discussions and confessions and so forth. So it's not exactly innovating in terms of moving the theater forward formally. It's like a subject matter from the 1980s given a 1950s sort of format. And Kramer himself seemed to acknowledge that. Then, shortly thereafter, after the success of The Normal Heart, he got involved in this group called Act Up, group performance in a radical way outside of the theater. Act Up was a group of mostly men and gays who wanted the government to do to fight AIDS and provide resources to understand the disease better and to take care of those who were victims of the disease. And to make their point, they staged all of these actions in government buildings and public places, and often got arrested because they were very serious. They sometimes assaulted public persons or disrupted meetings and prevented people from speaking because they were very intense. And their purpose was to make a big noise about AIDS, which otherwise wasn't going to take place as people would whisper about it. Not sure how to deal with it. Meanwhile, people dying from it. So ACT UP felt that it had to be much more aggressive, public, and disruptive if the country was going to get focused on AIDS research and care for those who suffered from the disease. But it was a kind of theater. Larry Kramer got involved. He was a director of the ACT UP organization that just felt the regular theater who's doing a play about AIDS is not going to awaken consciousness. You have to move the performance out into the streets and into public buildings and take over people's lives. They would act up. They would act up. They would dress up. They would play these roles in these public things and conduct a different kind of discourse with public officials, with the media, and with citizens in these public spaces to dramatize the crisis of this epidemic, this disease. So it's a kind of important theater that went on in the United States in the 1980s and into the 1990s.